Some films were harmed in the making of this podcast. From Edmonton, Alberta, Canada, and the Palatial FYC Studios, you are listening to For Your Consideration,
the podcast featuring roundtable discussions reevaluating the cinematic canon of past masterpieces and modern classics. I'm your host, Dustin Friesenan.
And I'm your host, Mike Josick. And we'd like to welcome everybody who's catching the show on all good podcatchers or YouTube or Spotify or Apple Podcasts. And if you happen to be getting the show off of Apple Podcasts, we would appreciate a rate and review. If you can give us 5 stars is always welcome, but go with how you feel, and a review of the show. It all helps with the algorithms and getting the show into the eyes and ear people who might be interested in checking the old podcast out. If you are a regular listener, welcome back. And if you are a brand new listener, just a warning, spoilers ahead. So if you heard last week's episode, you might know that this week we are covering a pick of Dustin's. And that movie would be another foreign film, Korean film, Bong Joon-ho's 2006 kaiju horror comedy, The Host.
AKA The C-Team. When the A-Team's too busy and the B-Team is taking the week off, you get these guys. I love it when a thing that we were trying to do just sort of happens, I suppose.
So I'll just jump into the credits right away so that we could get to discussing this film. So The Host was directed by Bong Joon-ho. It was produced by Choi Young-bae. It was written by Bong Joon-ho, Ha Won-jin, and Baek Chul-hyun. It starred Song Kang-ho, Byun Hee-bong, Park Ha-il, Bae Doona, and Go Ah-sung. Music was by Lee Byung-woo. Cinematography by Kim Hyung-koo. It was edited by Kim Sun-min. Distributed by Showbox Entertainment. And I believe premiered in Korea on July 27th, 2006. The film was really well received on its release. It won several awards, and obviously was a film that exported to North America, so popular enough over there to get distribution over here. Really well received by critics pretty much internationally. It holds a 93% approval rating on Rotten Tomatoes. Filmmakers like Quentin Tarantino included it on their list of top 20 films released since 1992. It's number 81 on Empire's list of the 100 best films of world cinema.
And it was well enough received to reach 377th on the BFI's Top Films of All Times critics poll. Though, even though Tarantino apparently really liked it, I guess he didn't vote for it or wasn't included in these votes. I wonder who and how you get on there. I know I'd like to be on there. 2022, come on.
So this was my second or third time watching the film. Dustin, how many goes have you had at The Host prior to this?
This is my second viewing, though this time I'm going in knowing what to expect.
Yeah,
when it all goes back down to expectation.
Yeah, when this movie first came out, I remember seeing people like blogging about it and just talking about what an amazing movie it is. And they were talking about it's this horror movie and you got to see it. It's from Korea. I finally got around to seeing it, and it was not what I expected it to be by any stretch of the imagination. So I'm curious, having both of us revisiting it for the episode to see, I guess, how it held up. So Dustin, as per usual, we start with you. What are your thoughts on The Host?
Well, what I remember from my first viewing of The Host is that I knew it was supposed to be a kaiju film. That's sort of how it was advertised to me. Monster film, kaiju in particular. So I was expecting big old monster running around destroying stuff. Whenever I think kaiju, I always think Godzilla sized. I never think anything small. And I think that Cloverfield came out sort of around the same time, or at the very least I'd seen that one first and then moved on to The Host. So I was expecting a lot more action, a lot more body count pretty much. And so I was expecting a lot more sort of destruction and whatnot, but I was pretty much disappointed at the time because of the middle section of the film, which I didn't appreciate at the time being the young dumb idiot that I was. Now revisiting it, I very much appreciate the family and the dark humor that Bong Joon-ho is going for and that I see in all of his stuff. I saw it in Snowpiercer. I look forward to seeing Parasite. But I loved the family just trying to do what it is that they can do to try and save the idiot's daughter. And when I say that they're sort of like the C team, I was thinking that while I was watching the film, you've sort of got Face, you've got sort of B.A. Baracus, you've got everybody in there, man. And it made it funnier for me. Trying to remember what their actual names were in the film.
Well, their last name was Park. And you've got Gang Du, who's the clumsy guy. You've got Hee-bong, who's the father. You have Namil, who is the...
We got father, sister, brother, grandpa, pretty much, is how I'll refer to them.
Namil is the brother, and Namju is the daughter, and Hansio is the daughter of Gang Du, the one who gets hijacked by the creature. And neither of us are going to remember these names consistently throughout.
Let's not pretend. I'm terrible with names at the best of times. Apologies to half my family whose names I don't know after 30 some odd years. But I was sort of seeing the father as B.A. Baracus just going around trying to throw everybody through a window, smashing whatever shit he can get his hands on. The crazy brother who's drunk all the time, he was sort of mad dog. You've got Face as the sister, the effective person who could actually deal with somebody else. And the grandpa with the plan is, of course, the good old leader.
Hannibal.
And it amused me the entire time. Good old Hannibal. All he was missing was the cigar.
That's a really interesting take on it. It's leagues away from anything I was thinking at the time, but I appreciate
it. And leagues away from anything that they were going for, quite frankly. Because, of course, obviously there's a lot of bureaucratic and government incompetence going on. That is definitely a theme that's running through the whole thing, starting with the jackass American general just like, oh, just pour all the formaldehyde down. It'll just go into the river, whatever. Don't even worry about it. Like, what the hell, man? There's proper disposal methods. They're being questioned at every turn. And the Americans are just complete turds in this film. Just military bureaucracy that's lazy and doesn't want to spend money on anything, which is weird because the American military gets more money than probably anybody else in the world.
The commentary was definitely fairly ham-fisted, I think.
Oh, yeah. It's done to the point of satire, right?
Yeah, exactly. And that's the thing that sort of surprised me, I think, when I first saw the film. I thought I was going in to see an actual, you know, like monster movie, a scary movie. And this thing, it rides that line, like all of Bong's movies do, where you have, you know, the clumsy character, you have the social commentary, the incompetence of bureaucracy, you have the genuine horror element, and you have the family elements, and like, it's kind of all there. And like, same as you, I didn't appreciate it the first time around either, because it was not what I expected going in. And I kept sort of waiting for the movie that I thought I was going to see to happen. And it never really did. So revisiting it this time was interesting, because it sounds like I had a somewhat similar experience to you.
But you look at the incompetence of the government and all the organizations that it's like, just go out there and shoot the damn thing. You have a family that's just trying to do one simple thing, and that's save the daughter. And it's all they wanted to do the entire time, and no one else was going to do it, so it had to be them. Which I think that's part of the reason why the A team sort of got into my head. It's like, when you can't call anyone else, who else do you call, right?
Yeah. And that's actually one of the strengths of the film too, is that you're not dealing with the government response to the creature. You're not dealing with the media response to the creature. You're dealing with it on this tertiary level, where you're dealing with this family who has lost a member, who doesn't have, you know, this isn't like watching the Dean Devlin, Roland Emmerich, you know, Godzilla or whatever, where you're going at it, where people have access to all these areas and they've got the helicopters and the tanks and the everything. It's like they're struggling.
And this isn't John Wick, where you've got people who are skilled at anything. These are people who have no clue what the hell they're doing, bungling around, almost like Inspector Clouseau for the most part.
Even the most capable person, played by the sister, she's the archer, but even she's like only so competent as far as dealing with this big creature.
Well, her slow reaction speed gets her knocked out for a good chunk of time. And in the end, I found it especially amusing that the person who sort of takes out the creature is a combination of her and some random homeless guy who saved the drunken brother after he jumped off a bridge. He's just wandering around with a bunch of gasoline. He's like, I'm just going to pour this on, you know, have fun with that.
I did like how, I mean, we're kind of jumping to the end here, but when he brings everything to kind of a conclusion, each family member who's left essentially plays a role. And it wasn't just Gangdu who, you know, got to save the daughter because he's the dad. You know, it was the whole family doing their thing. And the daughter actually doesn't survive. Actually
save the daughter, yeah. That's actually a beautiful part of it, that you don't get the nice, tidy, wrapped up in a bow thing that you would in so many other films. Instead, you get people who are just sacrificing everything in order to help one another. His daughter sacrifices her life in order to save this other random kid that she finds, whose father was also not very helpful in general. And because of that sacrifice, Gangdu decides that he's going to raise this other kid whose daughter saved, like to respect her memory and to just try and be a good person and just do the best that he can. And you look at his father, he's talking about how, or his father has the grandpa has this speech where everyone's giving Gangdu crap because he goes to falls asleep all the time. And he figures that, well, he didn't have the attention, the nutrition that he needed. He developed wrong. Like he's messed up and he's doing what he can. And that's like the crux of the film right there. People are just doing what they can in a world that they don't have control over.
And there's
to everybody.
And there's a nice arc for the family because they start off where they kind of bicker a lot and they seem to not really like each other. And in the end, the only reason, you know, the mission as it were succeeds is because the family pulls together and plays their roles.
So really it's a family drama that just happens to have sort of the kaiju attack as a backdrop. And I always love films that are sort of mixing of genres like that. Obviously, I didn't appreciate it the first time I saw it, but this time around, I was definitely able to. And even the action scenes, when they do happen, are quite good. When the creature's running through the crowds at the beginning, jumping into the container or the shack where everyone's hiding out.
Oh, like that trailer or whatever? Really
fun movements. Oh, yeah. And everyone's trying to get out the other side and Gangdu's trying to help them out. Then the random American comes by to save everybody, but gets his ass killed. Which actually brings me back to government incompetence, because they start talking about this disease that they think appeared, but turns out it didn't actually exist, but they're quarantining people anyway, and they're acting like this, acting like that. It is bureaucracy at its finest.
There were definitely elements of this film watching it now, especially, you know, the way things have been going in 2020 and they're talking about the virus and, you know, people getting tested and people getting quarantined and all this stuff. It was kind of like weirdly timely.
How's it timely that the government was dealing with misinformation, didn't act fast enough or properly and just started throwing people around and that the Americans really fucked everything up? Hi, Americans.
We kind of ride Americans a lot on this podcast.
I'm that douchebag that the comments say.
I guess we're Canadian, so we're supposed to maintain our polite moral superiority.
See, I was riding him. I wasn't claiming that we were superior, so you're the racist one here.
Oh, hey.
That's what I'm going with. Heyo.
One of the things that surprised me watching the movie this time around was I forgot, like, it's clearly shot on digital, and it has this quality to it. It looks like, you know, what we would sort of consider a lower budget kind of independent film, the way it's sort of shot, the way it looks. And for some reason, I don't remember it looking that way. And watching it this time, I was treating it more as a smaller film, if that makes any sense. And it kind of made me appreciate some of the scale of it more. And I'm not actually sure what the budget of it was or what the scale of the production was now that I think about it. But that's just definitely the vibe that I got from it. And I mean, I can see
sort of what you mean, that if you had the bigger budget, the cleaner cameras.
I've seen Snowpiercer, I've seen Parasite, and they do have, you know, different looks to it than this. This has a little bit more of that. I'm having trouble like nailing the word that I'm looking for, but it's...
I'd actually say it has sort of a personal feel when you have sort of that lower budget look. It feels like the scale is lower, which it is. It's just one family. It's not what's going on in the whole country. It actually has a lot of resemblance to Cloverfield in that sense. It's about a group of people trying to save one person during monster attacks. It's not necessarily low scale, but low I want to say low perception because of the point of view, sort of a limited point of view. There is that different feel that you'd get from some of the higher budget things. And I think that's the feel that I was looking for when I was trying to watch it the first time. But here, knowing what to expect and being able to go in with a more open mind, I think it was the right feel to go with.
I think the vibe that I'm getting off of it is looking at the cinematography, looking at the lighting of it, it's cleverly shot and cleverly directed, but there isn't a lot of like mood lighting or atmosphere. It's shot very sort of naturalistically, and it sort of has that digital video look to it, different from the look that, like I said, films like Snowpiercer or Parasite had, which I feel had a lot more of a deliberate sort of look to it as far as the lighting is concerned.
I wonder if that's an actual thing that's sort of going on in our heads nowadays after seeing so many films, especially ones these days where the lighting is so precise, where the direction is so precise, where everything is so directed and they deal with so many minute details, that when you have something that's shot natural, there is that different look that almost seems sort of indie, that seems lower budget, even though it is something that's more real. And it's like when I see a real surgery, it doesn't look like a real body anymore. It's like that looks fake because I've seen so many horror or action movies where it's completely coloring our minds as to what reality should be, that reality looks fake.
And I keep mentioning those other two films, and you know, particularly after seeing Parasite, Bong is a director who kind of knows what he's doing. This, I think, was his second film, so it might be because of that it has the look, and maybe the style has developed sort of over time. But I kind of have the sense that this is a very deliberate look, but it's kind of a almost sort of an unspecific deliberate look, if you know what I mean.
Bong Joon-ho who when he directs, his directing style is that he planned it so far in ahead that he would do essentially one take. He'd film it entirely chronologically, even with just one camera. He'd say, okay, now you say this. Okay, stop. Now I'm going to move over here. And then we film this. Okay, you stop. Now we go over here and film this. Because he knew exactly what angles. He didn't have to edit it all together. He just did the one angle and he had exactly what he wanted at that time. I think I was reading on Snowpiercer, and that's what he did there. And it was such a different experience to the actor who was talking about it.
Interesting. I think just to kind of put a punctuation mark on my whole kind of discussion about the cinematography, it's very possible that this look was chosen to give it more of a documentary look, to give it more of a real on the ground sort of look, and to not go too stylized with it. It's honestly a movie that, aside from kind of seeing it a couple times, I really haven't done much research into it. So I couldn't say for sure, but
what I've read on Bong Joon-ho is that he is very deliberate. So I would suspect that everything that you see is what he wanted you to see.
Yeah.
That is the level that you'd be looking at. That's the lighting you'd be looking at, the cinematography that he wanted you to see. I would have zero doubt about that. And I wouldn't really attribute it to a lack of skill, because anywhere else you see that he's doing exactly what he intends on doing. I don't feel that there's like excess here. Whenever something lingers for a long time, like them crying at the shelter when they think that the daughter is dead, and they're all just writhing on the ground like idiots after a certain point, like it's lingering on them, but it's on purpose.
I'm glad you brought that up, because I wanted to ask you, that was so over the top comedic. And then after that scene is the scene where the guy comes in the hazmat suit or whatever, and literally does like a banana peel slip on the floor and like falls down and gets up and tries to act cool again. And then that whole scene is played up where he's telling you, you know, what the government is going to do. And he's like, it's going to be on the news, and then it's not on the news. And then he's like, okay, well, anyways, this is what it's going to be. It's obviously playing up that satirized, you know, government incompetence kind of thing, but it's not subtle. It's very slapstick and very kind of in your face comedy. And that threw me off the first time I watched the film. This time I appreciate it a lot more, partially because I'm more experienced with some other films of Bong's, but it still kind of weirdly left an impression on me watching this one, where it felt really broad. And I was wondering kind of where you stood on that.
It feels not just like a satire of bureaucracy and government, but also of the film genre and some filming tropes as well. Like, I adored the fact that he was trying to get the news on, but they weren't there. It's like, well, I guess it's not on quite yet, so I'll tell you instead. Because every other show, someone just flicks to the right channel and boom, there it is every single time. So I love that he put a lampshade on it.
You're right.
And that's the thing. We are in a... This film is a lamp store. There are just lampshades everywhere on stuff. And he's pointing out all sorts of little things here and there that you'd see in certain films, or just bringing attention to ridiculous scenes. Yeah, it's slapsticky, but that is entirely intentional. You can tell that he's going for sort of a very dark humor. And if it's not your style, then it's not going to work. But there is some fun stuff that goes on, that is for sure.
I mean, it definitely has more in common with a movie like Gremlins, you know, than it does with, I don't know,
Gremlins 2 in particular.
Yeah, like it wears its multi-genre self hard on its sleeve. I think had I known that going in the first time, I would have had a different impression of it. But again, like you, I was told it's amazing and I went to see it and got something very different. I do appreciate the storytelling and the directing and stuff in it now. But it does, you mentioned the middle part and it is paced oddly. I will say that. That is something that I noticed this time around. I think I felt that the first time too, but this time it has a weird sense of momentum to it.
But yeah, the middle part, it really slows down for a good long time. And I remembered the beginning and I remembered that they fight it again at the end. So when they get captured and they're not allowed to leave, I'm like, okay, they got to escape. But then they get caught again and they all get split up. And I'm like, I know how it ends. How the heck does it actually get there? It seems almost like it was one capture too many, pacing wise. Because the second time they lose the grandpa and then the brother and sister are hiding out in completely disparate places. And they're talking about killing Gang Du to figure out if he's got this virus, which might be in his brain, even though they know that there is no virus. It's like, why are you doing this? Did somebody write it down on a piece of paper somewhere? Because I know exactly how that works, where some higher up wrote something down on a piece of paper, and apparently ink is a chisel and paper is stone, because you got to do it even if it makes no sense anymore. And you know that
I do think the stuff that's in that middle third is relevant, and there's a lot of interesting stuff going on, there's character stuff going on, but yeah, I can't let go of sort of the weird pacing of it. And, you know, it's been a good 10, 15 years since I've seen this movie. So kind of going into it again, probably had a lot of that first time feels to it, other than some of the stuff that I kind of remembered about it. So maybe if I was to watch it again more recently, like closer to my last viewing, I might appreciate that middle part more. It wouldn't feel quite so oddly paced, but maybe not.
At the same time, I wonder if that's sort of intentional, because the pacing isn't so clean, but neither is anything else that goes on in the film. Nothing happens nice and clean like you'd expect in other films. Is it intentional or is it not? That's and it's really true. Hard to tell, because I think that so much of what he does is intentional, but it's also an earlier film of his, and I don't know at this point. But the fact that we're questioning it is pretty much the answer to an extent.
I would love to hunt down an interview or something, or listen to an audio commentary or something with Bong and just kind of hear some of the intentionality behind the film and some of the choices made. And like I said, there's character bits. There's really important, really well done, well shot, well acted, well written bits in that middle third. But yeah, it's the whole movie subverts the genre, subverts expectations. He probably wanted you to go into this movie that you thought was a horror movie, and it's like, here's the monster, and then you just go away from the monster, because like you said earlier, this is a family drama in a kaiju movie sweater kind of thing.
And with Bong Joon-ho's classic weird comedy style. I do look forward to seeing Parasite. If I can say anything, it's that watching this has made me really want to see Parasite.
Parasite is brilliant. It really is. It deserves all the accolades it gets. Before we shut down, I just wanted to ask you about the creature itself and the effects in the film. And, you know, there are moments where I did think, okay, this is like early 2000s, you know, CGI. And obviously I think a fair amount of the film's budget probably was, you know, effects related. But I think for the most part, the monster works really well. And the way it's integrated with the other elements, he doesn't cheat it. He's not doing like tons of shaky cam. You get a lot of close-ups of the creature. There's a lot of interactions with the creature. I was really, really impressed with how that was handled. How about you?
I saw Mortal Kombat Annihilation last night. So I can say that I don't think CGI got that much better from 1997 to 2006. It's not. It's the host has good CGI. It works. It feels right. It doesn't look too dated. It's not perfect. It's not as good as we're used to these days. But looking at Mortal Kombat Annihilation or looking at other Asian films of the same time, you don't always expect that kind of quality. Japan, for example, they tend to have not as good CGI even nowadays. A lot of lower budget kind of stuff. You were questioning the budget, and I've definitely seen some bad CGI to compare it to.
I was watching Shin Godzilla.
Worked out quite well.
Not that long ago, and I actually prefer the visual effects in this film over what I saw in Shin Godzilla. And I mean, people fucking love Shin Godzilla.
I was reading on the inspiration for the creature itself, though, because the writer had an experience with... Sorry, he didn't have the experience. He was reading an article on formaldehyde being thrown into the lake. So it's basically based off of a real event to an extent.
Yeah,
and he wanted to come up with something where, okay, you have a fish that's mutated. So let's get sort of the extra limbs. Let's do this and that. It was all very intentional when he was creating the creature to be something that's sort of mutated, but still able to move around and be effective. Even just having it run around on two legs as opposed to four, in spite of having how many different fins going on and having an extra long tail to balance itself. It's a very interesting creature design.
There was an article, I guess, or the same article that you're talking about. There was a fish that was pulled out of the Han River that had like an S-shaped spine, and it was a mutation. And yeah, so that was kind of the inspiration for, I guess, the whole idea of the movie, actually, the chemicals in the river creating a creature and wreaking havoc. But
at the end of the day, the creature is just doing its thing. It's just trying to live and trying to be itself.
And at the end
which is the case with so many of these things, except for Godzilla, which is somehow gone from a scathing critique of nuclear weapons to a defender of America and the world using nuclear power. So I feel like that it might have gone a little bit backward there.
Oh, it's even evolved past that. Now the kaiju are forces of nature that are like there to balance, you know, the powers on the planet kind of thing. Like when things go out of balance, the kaiju arrive to set things back into place. But
then the balance is messed up by King Ghidorah. It's all over the show. And so the real question that I will pose to you, Mike, is if Parasite is a masterpiece, as you seem to be saying, is The Host a masterpiece as well?
As I said, the first time I watched it, I had mixed feelings, though I recognized that it was an interesting, well-made movie. Second time, wasn't really sure what I was going to be thinking. I kind of thought I was going to go masterpiece because of my experience with Bong since then. And as much as I enjoyed watching The Host, I don't feel like it hits masterpiece level. You know, a lot of things are working in this movie, but I'm going to go museum piece for The Host.
And I'm going to have to agree with you. I think it could use a bit more polish, in particular around the middle. And the satire could be a bit more biting and a little less slapsticky, even if that's what they're going for. When you think of comparing it to other films of the genre, since it's so genre-defying, it's a little hard to sort of compare and contrast, but it's not as good as other films of any of the other genres. They're not as integrated and as well balanced as he does in future films. So you can see where he's coming from. You can definitely see where he ends up later on, but this one is not as polished as it would take to become a masterpiece, I think.
That belongs in a museum.
It definitely looks like an artifact of, or the product of a filmmaker who has a lot of really cool ideas, who has skill, who has, you know, the temerity or audacity to just go in a lot of really weird directions. But yeah, it doesn't have the kind of balance that I would have wanted it to have to go masterpiece. And that balance is something that I feel I've seen in other films of Bong's. So,
or yeah. Other films that one would compare with The Host.
Yeah. So considering how torn I've been with some of the decisions in the last, you know, handful of episodes, I'm really comfortable with this one.
But I will say it is on the upper level of museum piece films. That's the thing. It's not like just an either or. There's different levels within it. It's one where even though we're comfortable calling it a masterpiece, or sorry, a museum piece, it's one that still had debate. We didn't go into it saying, no, this thing's a pile of garbage.
And that's something that I think also...
This thing only belongs here.
I think that merits clarification as well. Like, we say masterpiece, museum piece, and I think some people, when we say a museum piece, they think we're saying that it's a steaming pile of shit. But museum piece is still saying this is a classic film. Like, this is still a really good film. And masterpiece just means it's like top tier. It's upper echelon. This is the kind of thing that you want to put in the time capsule and have, you know, future civilizations look at and go, yeah, you know what? I think that was really incredible cinema. And
whereas a museum piece, I tend to feel is something that, well, it belongs in a museum. You go to a museum to see something that is of quality, but is not something that we'd really have around nowadays. You go, you look at ancient Greek pots. Well, we don't use that anymore, but it's something that's interesting to see from a number of perspectives. But a masterpiece is something that you'd still want to have in your home, something that you'd still use. One of those early age inventions that just sticks around forever.
Like a ladder.
Like a ladder.
I was trying to
Ladders
think of
are still great.
Ladder just came to mind. And this is 100% an enjoyable film. And I would recommend this film to other people. And I would watch this film again with or without audio commentary because it's fun. It's a fun time. You know, there's a lot worse ways you could spend 2 hours, but yeah, there you go. I just, you know, there's been a lot of messages on YouTube, which have been in the negative category or tone. So, you know, just for anybody who's actually listening to the shows and is maybe taking our intent in that direction that we don't intend it to, I just thought, we're coming up on our anniversary. Let's give another, like, let's lay down a clarification.
Because we can absolutely love a film and think everything about it is great and it just be a museum piece because of whatever reasons.
And if we
just really... like there can be a film that we don't like but think is a masterpiece, although that tends to be a bit more rare.
And if we really think it's shit, we don't hide it.
Oh yeah, I've voted stuff off the island before.
So
I think there's 5 films I voted off the island.
So there you have it. That's how Dustin and I went. 2 votes for museum piece for Bong Joon-ho's 2006 kaiju comedy horror, The Host. We'd love to know what you guys think of the film. We prefer not to hear it if you think either of us are douchebags.
No. Call me a douchebag all you want. That just tells me that you listened to me long enough to truly get me, you know?
And you can let us know on any of our social media. We're on Facebook, we're on Twitter, YouTube comment wall. We're basically for your consideration or at FYC Show on all those platforms. And I guess there's also FYCShowMail@gmail.com if you want to send us an email. And like, share, follow, subscribe across the board and all the platforms. If you know anybody who you think would like the show, feel free to share us on your social media. Word of mouth is a great way to get the show around. And that's all there really is to say about that.
So the question is, given that this was my choice, what is your next choice there, buddy?
My pick. It was actually torn between 2 things, but I'm going to go with Before Sunset because I'm kind
of... Was the other choice Annie Hall because you've been...
No, the other choice was actually Pinocchio.
Pinocchio?
Yeah.
Like the Disney Pinocchio?
Like the Disney Pinocchio.
I didn't even know it was on the list.
You know what? I should probably double check. I have a tendency to make that error.
Wouldn't be the second time.
I don't even know if it'd be the third time. But yeah, I chose to go with Before Sunset. I'm in a bit of a Ethan Hawke Before Trilogy kind of mood lately. And you know what? It's like an 85-minute movie, so it's nice and tight. Haven't done just like a really calm, sort of straightforward American kind of romantic drama in a while or at all. I can't remember the last one.
Nor I. But I can say that Pink Flamingos is apparently on the list. Pinocchio is, as well as Pirates of the Caribbean 3.
Three?
Three.
Wow.
At World's End. Apparently that is the one that makes the list.
Wow. You know what? I'm kind of tempted to go Pirates. It's been a while, and it is not my favorite Pirates movie. But anyways, yeah, so be sure to...
That is neither here nor there.
Be sure to join us next time on the podcast for Before Sunset. Until then, I've been your host, Mike Josick.
And I've been your other host, Dustin Friesenham.
Stay safe, stay healthy, and we'll catch you next time on the podcast. Take care.
Ta-ta.